So like I was saying, how to test the hay and then how to submit a sample. And then once you submit that sample, what exactly are you looking for? You're going to get that analysis back with multiple different numbers and letters on it. What does all that mean? How does that make sense? And then why is that important? We kind of heard a little bit from our presenters earlier about putting that into your ration, and the nutritional requirements of cattle differ depending on their production stage. And so that's something that needs to be taken into account. Do they need more protein because they are lactating and trying to keep up body condition score, get ready to rebreed? Or are they in a maintenance position, mid-gestation, when they don't need quite so much? And having a hay test done and knowing what is in your forage, what's in your hay, what you're feeding those animals, that is going to be vital information that you need to be an efficient operator. So, how to collect a sample. So there are multiple different types of hay samplers and hay probes out there. Scott, he's got one that you got the hay probe cutting in with a hand crank on it. You just kind of crank that into the hay bale. I am not quite that ambitious. I've got a drill. And this one on the right-hand side is the one that I've got. And what you do is you take that cutter and you insert this into the hay bale to gain your sample. And the drill just acts as your motor to rotate that cutter head as it's moving through the hay bale. Now, with the one that I've got, you've got the long metal probe with the cutting end on the end of it. And some of them are just a straight blade, others are serrated, it depends on the type. But you want to have a nice, good, sharp cutter right there. That way you're going to get a clean cut through that hay bale. You're not going to shred the sample, which could create finer pieces of the bale and actually reduce the amount of fiber that your sample says it has, so it can skew your sample. So it's really important to make sure that your hay probe is always sharp. And then as that sample goes into the probe, it'll go down into the black, that black tote. And then I, for those online, you can't see this, but I always put a Ziploc bag right under mine. And that way, after I take my sample, everything's just all in the bag. I seal it up right on it. What the sample identification is, and it's ready to send in. Now, when testing these bales, I was also going to mention on all these, and usually on any forage probe that you'll find, they usually have a good ramrod because they will get clogged up after about. I usually try and push everything down the bore about every two bales, and you do one sample per bale. And so when you're looking at you come to a stack and you're thinking, okay, how am I going to sample these bales? Who can tell me where on this hay bale I need to put my probe in? Am I going to put it in over here on the string side, on the big side, a lot of area there? Where am I going to be putting my probe? This is the interactive part.
Where it's easy to reach.
Okay, I like that. You're not going to go find the tractor or a ladder and get up to that very top bale, are you? You're probably going to get mostly these lower bales, which is fine as long as you do multiple of them and get what's called a representative sample of that stack. So you're going to get one that's easy, or at least a spot that's easy to get to. Where else? Anybody tell me?
Don't get the top or bottom that are weathered.
Don't get the top and bottom that are weathered. Yeah. I mean, you're going to get more mold and mycotoxins in there. The nutritional composition of that based on the mold or weathered areas are going to be a little compromised. So that's exactly right. So if I stick my probe in here, is this the best spot? Raise your hand if you think this is the best spot to stick that probe in. How about they're here on the string side? Okay, more people are doing that. Why on the string side?
Because there's only three that are exposed and the rest of them are on.
Well, okay, that too. You're going across the flakes, and that's something to think about. If you're going to be putting that in you don't want to stick it in on this side, on the flat side, because the flakes go vertical here. you want to stick it in on the string side and let that go in about 18 to 24 inches, as deep as that hay probe will go, because you want to go through each as many flakes as you can. A certain flake only represents maybe a 5 foot on a small bale, maybe 3 foot, 5 foot square. Of course, a larger area on these bigger bales, but it only represents a small area of that field. And so if you stick that in one leaf, you're not getting a very good representative sample. Whereas if you go crossways, you're going to get a small little bit of every single one of those leaves that you go through. And that's going to be a more comprehensive sample of what kind of a hay field do you have? And as that comes in, gets baled and puts in the stack, what are you going to be feeding to your animals? And so I usually start right there, and you want to go in the middle. Can anybody tell me, and we talked about the weather, you don't want to go necessarily in the top of those bales or the bottom bales, because they can be weathered or rotting a little bit, moldy. But there's one more reason that I can think of why you want to go in the middle of the bales. Can anybody think of another reason besides mold and being weathered? Leaf concentration. Very good. Because during that baling process, within that mechanical baler, it's shaking, moving a lot. Some of those leaves are going to shake off of the stems and move to the bottom of that bale. So if you sample more to the top of a bale, you might get more fiber and less of the leaf, which is going to skew, reduce your energy and protein that is contained in those leaves, and higher ADF and NDF values, which are more in the stem. And so when you stick it in the middle, you're going to get that representative sample, leaf and stem of the plant. And so you want to just do a random pattern, whatever is easy to access. And so just going from the middle here, and then I chose this another bale on the bottom, go up to the next one, and just do a random pattern all the way down the stack. Now you want to make sure that you don't put your hay probe in twice on the same bale, and don't just do five or six samples. You want to get roughly 20 samples per haystack to gain a representative idea of what is in that stack. Now, do I want to run my probe through this and then turn over and do this stack as well? Probably not, because this is actually different. I've got a stack of alfalfa here, whereas this is for some triticale bales. So different stacks, different fields, different cuttings. Those are some things you want to take into consideration when you're testing these forages. You want everything that comes out of the same field, same cutting, you can sample all together. And you want to test fairly close to when you're going to be feeding. You don't want to test this stack and then 8, 10 months, a year down the road, say, oh yeah, I've got that forage analysis. That's what I'm going to base my ration off of, because that hay will deteriorate over time, and your values may not be quite as accurate as they are a month after you take that test. So here's a guy, when I was getting some hay samples later on, those who are here, I've got some hay samples that we'll look at that you guys can look at earlier, do a little judging. We'll kind of play a little game with that. Look at which bale do you think is the best and high protein, high TDN, which is the cleanest bale out of all those, and some different things like that. We'll do that during lunch. But as I was getting those samples, had a gentleman take this picture. But again, going right in the center of that bale. And with alfalfa bales, they're usually denser, a little bit harder to get through. You have to use a little more effort. Whereas the grass bales, they're less dense and a little bit easier to get through. I've got a slide on this, but you have to be careful, because in grass bales, at least in my experience, if you don't have an extremely sharp cutter head, some of those grass, the leaves and everything will bind on your cutter and actually cover the cutting edge of your hay probe. And so if you feel like you're not getting it, you've got that drill on full blast, go ahead and pull it back out the bale and clean off that cutter head, because you also don't want your hay probe to heat up. And this is because when that metal gets nice and hot, and you're running a sample through it, it can heat up that sample and actually damage your sample. So you'd want to make sure that you're allowing that to cool down and not get too hot in between while you're doing these samples. Round bales. Where are you going to put that hay probe in these round bales, for those of you who feed round bales? On the round side or the curved side? On the curved side, for the same reason as the square bales. That's going to allow you to go through multiple layers of that bale, representing a larger area of your field. Make sure you remove, or at least move the netting on these bales, or if they're tarped, make sure you can open that up and don't let that get in your sample, because that will also compromise your sample. With hay, about a minimum of 20 cores, 20 to 25 is usually what I'm trying to get within a stack. And again, the 12 to 18 inches, honestly, go the full depth of that hay probe, because that allows you to get more idea of what you're doing. If you've got silage and you're going to do that, just a comment, you want to dig into that face, not right on the face of your silage pit, because you have a little oxidation there. And so dig back in about 6 inches, take a handful, and do that in about 12 to 20 spots in the face. And then you can reduce that sample to a manageable size that you can send in. Tips for different kinds of hay. I've already kind of talked about that. Be careful on how hot that hay probe gets, because you don't want to cook that sample before you get it to the lab. As soon as you got it done and you take that all of the sample that's in your bag, take the bag off. I've got a rubber band to keep mine on. You seal it shut. Make sure that all the air is out of that. Not as important with a forage sample, particularly a dry forage sample, but especially with silage or in silage feeds, you want to get all that air out, because that's going to allow that to be just a nice clean sample. It's not going to it's not going to continue fermenting on its way to the lab. Send off as soon as possible. I mean, after you take this sample, I know some people have just taken that sample, they hop back in the truck, throw it up in the dash on a cold winter day, that hot air is blowing in, and they drive around doing a couple errands, and then they make it to the post office maybe 4 hours later. Well, that heat is going to compromise your sample. So get it. Don't let it be near heat. If you can freeze refrigerate that sample, that's also totally acceptable. And store it. And then when you write on that, make sure you write your name, the date you sampled that, and also an identifier for you to know when you get that analysis back. Okay, this was stack A of first cutting alfalfa this last year. So that you know and can use that as you start to feed that. And when you want to send this to a certified lab for either the wet chemistry or NIR, and here's a couple of the local, at least local labs that we've got. This website that I have listed here, the foragetesting.org, is a great resource. If you're looking to improve your operation, you want to do more of these hay tests, you can go on there, look at different hay probes that you can purchase. And also, it also lists out the labs you can send these samples to. The wet chemistry, that's going to be a little more in-depth, a little more costly, but more accurate analysis of your feed. However, most labs, if you can just send it in for an NIR analysis, it's a simpler, easier, cheaper, yet it's still a good analysis that'll get you the information you need. And when you fill these out, the sheets, you want to make sure you have all your information right up top and fill it out good. But what you're going to be picking, and for most operations, I usually just recommend the basic tests, which is only going to cost you, at least at Dairyland Labs, where I send a lot of mine to, not to say that it's the best or my favorite. It's just one I've sent one to and had good results with. They have a quick turnaround time. Usually when a lot of labs do, when you send off a sample, you usually can get results back within 4 to 5 days, sometimes sooner, depending on their workload. So it's a pretty quick turnaround when you send these out. But just the basic analysis for a normal producer we'll get you plenty of information. In fact, this is one of my samples that I sent off earlier this year, and just on an alfalfa sample, and you get all this information off of just a basic run. So you'll get your dry matter content up here, your crude protein based on a dry matter basis, your ADF, NDF, those fiber values, the plant structural components, lignins, sugars, ash, kind of a measure of the mineral content and dirt, how clean is that sample, some of your minerals here, and also a big one to look at, particularly when purchasing hay or feeding the cattle. We talked about the TDN and energy requirements of cattle, that TDN marker is right there, along with when you're submitting these to a extension educator or a nutritionist, these net energy requirement or net energy numbers are also pretty important. So you get all that information, all that valuable information off a $21 sample. I feel that's really worth it, particularly if you can save yourself some money. Within that, like I mentioned, that dry matter, and that's important to look at. If you've got a sample if you've got a hay that was baled a little bit more moisture than another, it's going to have a lower dry matter content. And when we're feeding and making rations off cattle, we base it off of dry matter content. And so the amount of feed that you're going to feed off of one bale that has an 85% dry matter is going to be different than another bale that's 90% dry matter. And you're going to have to do a little bit of calculations with that. So that's something to take into account. Crude protein, vitally important, particularly for younger animals and the animals during gestation. The ADF and NDF value, like I mentioned, those fiber, negatively correlated with digestibility. As that plant gets more mature, it has more lignin and the structural components, it's not going to be as digestible. And the energy goes down, usually protein goes down, palatability goes down. That ash and then the TDN already spoke about, both important numbers to look at. So that when you get that analysis back, make sure you're looking through that. See, and you can compare your stacks and talk to your neighbors about what your stack is like. And maybe this is something you can talk to your, if you have some poor quality hay, talk to your crop consultants about that and show them this. And this is what is showing up in my feeds. Do we need to do something different on fertilizing or irrigating or whatever it may be to make sure that your hay, or is your hay stand just old enough? It's just not real great quality and it's time to do a crop rotation on it. All good information you can find out from these samples. The Idaho Hay and Forage Association, when I'm looking at hay and talking to people about hay, I usually refer them, I pull this sheet out and talk about, when we talk about how good is my hay? Well, growing up, we would always, me and my dad, we'd go buy hay for the horses or whatnot, or helping the neighbors feed the cows. We'd look at a bale, and, oh yeah, it's nice, green, leafy bale. Yeah, that looks like some good hay, or some other that's been rained on or whatnot. That's poor quality, but that was just based off sight. So gaining this, you can actually, and this is a good marketing tool if you're a cattle producer and also growing some hay and selling it, or have some of this hay and maybe want to sell some of your supreme premium, really high quality hay, and maybe get some lower quality hay that still meets those nutritional needs of your cattle. Something to take into consideration. And these guidelines are for alfalfa and the grass hay bales. So some really interesting things to look at. Why do we test hay? Well, I can't stress the importance of it. We just gain that valuable knowledge of what are we feeding to these animals? What are these animals actually ingesting? And comparing that, as was mentioned in our first presentation by Megan, what are those requirements? And are we meeting the nutritional needs of these animals? And if so, great. Are we perhaps a little overboard and we can feed less and supplement with a lower quality? Or are we under the mark and we need to get some better quality forages to meet those requirements? And that just allows for more informed decisions, avoids wasting hay and money. We can save a little bit of money if we can feed those lower quality forages and still make sure that we are meeting the requirements of the animals. And some of these samples, I actually threw some of these into a ration building program. And I've only got a few more minutes here, but just to, just if you will, if you've got some of that supreme premium type hay running for roughly $300 a ton right now, that's going to cost you this number, that cost per day, about $4.58 if you're feeding, this is for a 1,200 pound cow 1 month after calving. And these are the nutritional requirements that, that I pulled out of the book, plugged in here to my ration program. So we're feeding about 26.8 pounds of dry matter. If you fed that 26.8 strictly of the supreme hay, you're going to be, it's going to cost you about $4.58 a day per cow. But you look here, you're meeting that energy requirements, but on the protein side, you're way over by 12, you're over by 12%. And so you're perhaps wasting a little bit of protein that you could be scaling back, and you're feeding too much protein. Whereas if you took that $300 ton hay and you only fed 20 pounds of it and you fed about 6 pounds of straw, and I put in a number of $70, that's kind of a straw of prices right now. I wasn't able to get a concrete number on that, but just say $70 a ton for now. That's going to go down to $379. So you're going to save some money, and that's per cow per day. And in the cattle industry, we go off cents. I mean, those cents can really make a difference by saving over 50 cents per cow per day, just by feeding less of the higher quality feed. So if you, in the same thing, even if you've got a what would be classified as a good quality hay, maybe running about $240 a ton, you're down to $367 just feeding that straight. When you add in a little bit of straw and reduce that, still meeting the requirements needed by that animal, you're bumping it down to $328 per cow per day. And so these are some things to think about, being able to save money, to save the feed, particularly with hay, with feed prices as they are, as we've talked about, sometimes hard to get. Using what you have, even if you got that poor quality stuff, can really just work in your favor. So again, thanks for coming. I'm going to be here the rest of the afternoon if you want to talk a little bit more. But right now, I'll take any questions. Sir?
How quickly does quality go down, if that's a true statement?
I honestly don't know. I mean, it depends on how it's stored a lot of times. I mean, your forages that are stored, that are tarped really well or in your hay shed, they're going to last a lot longer than those that are left exposed. But I don't have any specific percentages. It goes down 2% protein after 6 months or whatever like that. I'd have to look into that a little bit deeper. But that's a very good question, something to consider if you've got a stack that's been there for a year. Okay, we maybe need to think about feeding it, or it's been there for 6 months. We can let's feed this older stuff first. So something to think about for sure. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
On these lower quality forages, what in that sample will show you the nitrate content, see if we're getting some nitrate poisoning?
Yes. So the question was, and I didn't repeat the question earlier, but the question was, with these lower quality forages or forages that we've had a hard time irrigating them and have a risk at being high nitrate, within the basic sample that I did show, that does not have a specific, that does not give you any information on nitrates. However, let me go back. Let me see if I can go back to that. When you're getting ready to submit that sample, there are a lot of different tests that you can choose. Okay, so you can. I mean, if you're more of a feedlot operator or doing a lot of different feeds or something like that, you could go a little bit deeper and get more analysis done on that within this sheet. Let me see if it'll show up on this one. It's not, it's on the back side, it's on the reverse side of this form, but usually any lab that you'd send it to when you're filling out that form, it will have a spot that you can say, I want to test this for nitrates. And you add another $4 or $5 for that, for just to add the nitrate testing on that. But again, valuable information for that added $5. So whatever your lab you're going to be sending that sample to, look at their sheet, all the tests available, and make sure that you get a good NIR or wet chemistry analysis to give you the general nutritional information of that feed. And then if you are worried about the nitrates, or if you're feeding it to other animals and are worried about some of the more mineral content or vitamins, that is something that you can add on for a slightly extra fee.
In your analysis, I thought I recalled you showed the variability of each component. Is there a caution as to how variable I might get a result and decide to not go with that?
As far as just like in these nights?
Look at your ADF.
Okay.
And on the far right there, you're showing me something like min or max.
Yeah. So at this laboratory, they've kind of got that median range of what they usually see within and an alfalfa hay sample, and the 90% range, what are you looking for? So if you say, for instance, if you've got a sample and the ADF value comes back at like, oh, I don't know, just a random number of like 65 or something like that, you're going to say, man, it was super mature. It's probably going, when you look at that, you're going to say, man, this is my lower quality forage. Not necessarily that you wouldn't feed it, because like was mentioned earlier, whatever you've got, we can work it into a ration so that you can feed it. But just knowing that because it's a more mature hay, it's going to be less palatable, less digestible, and the TDN, total digestible nutrients, is going to be down on that. You just take that into consideration when you're creating that feeding protocol. So not necessarily, you can get to a point where the nitrates are bad enough that you're like, I don't know if I even want to even consider feeding this. But with some of these other values, it's kind of depending on the operation and depending on what you're able to feed to those cows and what you're doing. So,
Dr. Stigler.
Yeah, let me interrupt.
Yes, please.
You know, your diagnostic lab can run that nitrate analysis, and the problem with all these different labs, they use different methodologies, and so the results are different. And so if you're going to grab a nitrate off this feed analysis and want somebody to interpret it, I'm going to say, where'd you get it done? And then I'll wonder if it's the right number or not, just because. And it's only like $5 at the diagnostic lab that has that too. So if you're really concerned about nitrate poisoning, I would just take it to the diagnostic lab. Because those are good. And if you're monitoring it, over years, then you've got a handle on kind of what they're doing there. But with things like nitrates and selenium, I had a really hard time interpreting from every lab in the world when there's so much variability in the, and they don't test one another like they do in the tox departments, like in a diagnostic lab. You know, they'll do these round robin things to make sure that they're all given the same numbers. So just a word of caution on the nitrate. That might not be worth your $5. It might be better to send it to the lab.
Right. And for those online who didn't hear that, you have to be careful when you're sending in some of these more diagnostic tests like the nitrates or things like that to some of these laboratories who specialize in the forage testing and nutritional component analysis. It's a good place to start. But if you're really having problems with that or are very concerned about that, send it to the diagnostic lab at USU has a great one, University of Idaho. Just find a good diagnostic lab. And if you really want to get deep into some of these analysis, you could take a sample and send it to three different places and get all those results back and kind of get an average feel for that. So anyway, good comments, good questions. Any last things before everybody's probably itching to get to lunch, so I'll shut up.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Best thanks.
You're going to mention now.
Oh, yeah. So during lunch, go ahead and get your lunch. I'm sure Ben will talk about that. Right out these doors, I've got 5 hay samples. And this sample that I grabbed from some local producers and hay growers. And what I want you to do just for fun is to take a look at that visually. And we'll come back after lunch, right before we start up again. And I want you guys to identify just by sight, without doing a sample, which one of those has the highest protein, which one of those is the highest TDN, which is the cleanest bale, the least amount of ash, and which is the driest or the wettest bale. Some of those different things that you can get in the sample, we'll come back, talk about that, and then I'll actually, I sent in samples on all five of these. We'll actually look through some of those and chat about that for a minute. So we'll play with that.
Thanks, Sawyer. So we're just about to lunch, and so just before we do that, I just want to take a moment to thank those that have sponsored lunch today. AgriBeef has been a part of things since we started the symposium, and they have been very good to us in providing meat for our meetings throughout the week. And so this year we've gotten double R ranch tri-tip, and so that comes from AgriBeef. And then Eli Hansen Agency Farm Bureau Insurance is also a lunch sponsor. And so if you would, let's give our sponsors for lunch today a round of applause and thank them for doing that. Now, just before we go to lunch, a couple things. So for those of you online, if you would like to participate in this, you might want to get a pen and paper real quick. So if you would like to participate kind of in some giveaways from one of our lunch sponsors, if you would like to text stock 2023, you could text that to 208-262-3932. So that's for you online. If you'd like to participate, this will go right to Eli's computer. And then after everybody in the room has a chance to scan a QR code and do the same text thing, he'll look to see who some winners are and then do that a little bit later. So again, you can text stock, STOCK, space 2023 to 208-262-3932. And so that's for those online. Same number here. And just before we go to lunch, I just want to give Eli a chance to come up and take a few minutes to visit with you, and then we'll go to lunch, and we'll get to that in just a moment.
Thanks, Eli. Appreciate it.
So we appreciate you guys letting us come and sponsor your lunch today. I hate to be the guy that stands between the 4 minutes between you guys and lunch, so we'll be fast. But I did want to talk a little bit about why I came here. 1911, American Farm Bureau was formed. A lot of you know about Farm Bureau, the Federation. It's the largest ag lobbying organization in the nation. And in 1939, Idaho Farm Bureau formed their own Farm Bureau Federation. 2 years later, 1947, Farm Bureau Insurance Company was formed because farmers were having a hard time getting insurance in the industry. So that was formed as a benefit of that insurance company. Everybody knows insurance companies and what they do. But part of what Farm Bureau does is every single policyholder that Farm Bureau has pays a portion of that premium, and it goes back into the Farm Bureau Federation, which goes back into the ag industry in Idaho. And one thing that we do the most of is our tagline for Farm Bureau Federation is Idaho Farm Bureau empowers agriculture in Idaho. And so we take care of those things in Idaho. And so we're not just an insurance company that takes care of you, or a revenue generation arm of the Idaho Farm Bureau Federation, which directly impacts private property owners, families, businesses, and people who are involved in agribusiness. So I want to talk a little bit about that for a second. Just so you know, this year alone, I got the numbers on the drive down here this morning, $25 million we paid out in claims, with another $98 million in outstanding reserves for the year 2022. That's right here, as they say, in River City. Those are all within the borders of the state of Idaho. We're the largest insurer in the state of Idaho. We're also the largest domestic insurer in the state of Idaho. And so about 3 years ago, I decided I want to do something a little different. I've done this for about 20 years. And so we built the first office on our own in the state of Idaho between Burley and Murtaugh. And so we have a team of about six people, and we're looking to rapidly expand what we do, and we give back to the community. We like to support people, but we wanted to get our name out there even more than it already is. We've been around quite a long time and had a lot of success. So anyway, before you get to lunch, we're going to give away some things, and I forgot to bring the box up. We're going to give away a gun. So anybody who's got a card on the table, take that. There is a text line on there. That's my 24-hour text line to my, me and my staff. So you can text that any time of day or night. I want you to text those words stock 2023. So stock space 2023. There's four questions it will ask you, and it will drop you into the contest. If you don't have a cell phone, raise your hand and I'll put you in that manually. And by the end of, if you don't like to text, I'll throw you in that list and our staff will have a winner by the end of lunch. But we're going to give away you can choose between a Ruger SR9C or a Taurus 9mm pistol. And so you'll have to qualify for that. So I'll pay for it, but you'll have to actually purchase it. Anyway, so text that in. We've got seven or eight other prizes. And so we'll just announce that after lunch. And then I just appreciate you guys. We surely do. And we appreciate the opportunity to take care of community members and families and farms and ranchers in the state of Idaho. So thank you.